بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. الحمد لله that we reach the last part of Ramadan, and as you know, the last third of Ramadan is definitely the best because the last 10 days includes Laylatul Qadr, the night of Qadr, which is better than 1,000 months, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. So within these 10 days is Laylatul Qadr. This is why these are the 10 days of dedication, 10 days of worship, 10 days of good deeds, 10 days of discipline. And interesting enough that we don't know which night it is. So we can do our best during the whole 10 days. So this is important. So you don't just, you know on the night and then forget about the rest. No, you do your best during the whole 10 days. So give your best, do your best. And this is the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the active, the strong, the generous, the kind. So this is our time to show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala good of ourselves. While Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah is talking about As-Siyam, if you notice, this is in verse 180 and forward, you will notice that in the middle Allah is talking about dua. So after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about fasting and siyam, that if you cannot fast and so on, immediately he says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, that if my servants ask you about me, then tell them I'm near, and I will answer the prayer of those who will pray to me. There is few indications here that this is the time of dua. This is the time Allah will answer our dua in Ramadan, in the days of fasting. Is important to make sure you make dua, right? But dua is important. Dua is not a complimentary thing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith, he said, "Ad-du'a huwa al-ibadah." Dua is the true ibadah. So it is not something just you do out of your curiosity or extra. Dua is the essence of ibadah. Is the ibadah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is turning our attention how to make the dua and how to make an acceptable dua. So Allah is saying, when my servants ask you about me, I'm always near. So this is the basic thing. The very important rule is Allah is near to everyone. And there is no mediator. There is no mediation. There is no one between you and Allah, not even your parents, no clergy, no imam, no one. It's between you and Allah. You talk to him directly. And you know what? Allah will not accept mediation. So Allah is telling us that he is near. Okay, Ya Rab, yes, but we make dua many times and dua is not answered. Is that right? Yes, it is, indeed. Does it contradict with this verse? Let's see what Allah is telling us. He said, I am near, I will answer your prayers. فَأُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ, when they pray to me, إِذَا دَعَان. But then immediately he's saying two words. And the key is in these two words. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. Let them respond to me and let them believe in me. This is where we should think very well. Why he's saying, let him respond to me? So respond to Allah. Do the dua the way Allah asks you to do it, and avoid things that will make the dua not answered. So let's respond to Allah. Responding to Allah means we need to do the things Allah asks us to do, and to avoid the things that he forbid us from doing. Because these things definitely will be stopping our dua from reaching the heavens or being answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as the Imam highlighted, there are few things, many things actually will stop our dua from being answered. Number one is to pray to Allah, but not to Allah only, with partners, associating partners, not to go with Allah directly, to go through mediators or to associate partners to Allah. Allah does not accept that. Allah, inna Allah aghna ash-shuraka. Allah aghna an ash-shirk. Allah doesn't need any partners. Allah doesn't need anyone to help him fulfill your wish. And if you do that, you are mistaken and you will lose your chance to be answered. So you need to ask Allah directly. Ask him without any mediation, without any associating any partner. Don't ask him even by anyone, by even the messengers. Ask Allah by his own names, by his own attributes. Oh Allah the giving, oh Allah the kind, oh Allah the merciful, oh Allah. Ask him by his beautiful names. Don't miss your chance by associating any partners to Allah. So ask Allah directly and ask him with his good names. Another thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is turning our attention to the halal, that our provision, our food and drink should be from halal, and if it's not from halal, this will stop our dua from reaching Allah. In the long hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah tayyibun la yaqbalu illa tayyiba." Allah is pure and he will only accept pure. This is the beginning of a long hadith, and towards the end of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيُطِيلُ السَّفَرُ. And he mentioned the man or the person who accumulates so many reasons for his dua to be answered. He's given an example of a person who takes all the means for the dua to be answered. Like what? Traveling. A person traveling, the dua is answered. Imagine if the person is traveling to Makkah. Imagine if the person is traveling and to Makkah and making dua next to the Kaaba, drinking Zamzam water and making the dua. All these are reasons for the dua to be answered. This person is accumulating so many reasons for the dua to be answered, but not only that, he's raising his hands to Allah. You know what? And raising the hands to Allah is another reason for the dua to be answered. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah la yastahi an yarfa'a 'abdahu yadayhi fayaruddahuma kha'ibatayn." Allah will be ashamed of a servant raising his or her hands to Allah and Allah will turn him down. Allah will not turn him down or her down. So the person will also raise his hands, and not only that, he will say Ya Rab, and saying Ya Rab is another reason. You're calling Allah by the name, he will answer the dua. Because you know what Rab means? Rab means Lord, means carer. And you're asking him, you are my Lord, you are my carer, take care of me. Allah will answer you. But you know, on top of all of that, Allah will not answer the dua of this person. Why? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explains, مَطْعَمُهُ مِنْ حَرَامٍ وَمَشْرَبُهُ مِنْ حَرَامٍ. His food is haram, his drink is haram, وَغُذِيَ بِالْحَرَامِ. And his body was built of haram. أَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ. How would his prayers would be answered? How can Allah answer this person's prayers? He has all the reasons for the prayers to be answered, but the food is haram. So someone whose food, whose provision, his income from haram, should be careful. It will spoil everything. No matter what, the haram money, haram income will destroy everything. Just like someone who is bad to the parents could destroy all the other good deeds or delay it. So this is another reason not to answer the dua, although we have many other reasons to do that. Another reason not to answer the dua is what you are actually making in the dua. Is the dua you make. The Prophet ﷺ said, Allah will answer the dua as long as you don't transgress ma lam ya'tadi, or make dua with severing the ties of kinship, or biqati'ati rahim. So the dua you make should not include any aggression, and aggression in the dua is to make unfair dua against your children, against your parents, against your fellow Muslims with no rights. To ask Allah for something that is not your right, or to ask Allah to do something that is wrong, or to ask Allah something against your ties and kins, qati'ati rahim. Allah is asking you to take care of the rahim, and you are making dua to sever it. Allah will not answer that dua. Another reason not to answer the dua, which is against responding to Allah, is not to enjoin good and forbid evil. Because in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in part of the hadith, he said, لَتَأْمُرُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوُنَّ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You will have to enjoin good and forbid evil, or Allah will send an enemy against you and you will make dua and Allah will not answer it. Or the good of you will make the dua and Allah will not answer them, because you are not enjoining good and forbidding evil. And you know what? It's not the only the responsibility of a certain institution, the enjoining good or amr bil ma'roof and nahi anil munkar. It's everybody. We are the ummah of enjoining good and forbidding evil. We are the ummah of amr bil ma'roof and nahi anil munkar. This is our name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this name and privilege as His ummah, as long as we enjoin good and forbid evil. Don't you recall Allah saying, Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas? That is that all? No. Ta'muruna bil ma'roof wa tanhawna 'anil munkar. You being a good nation, or the best nation sent out to people, enjoining good and forbidding evil. This is the reason of being good ummah, or being the best ummah. If you don't do that, you are no longer the best ummah. Or you don't fulfill the condition, then you are not yet the best ummah. Enjoining good and forbidding evil is a must on everyone within their capacity. Within the home, within the society, within the state, within the whole world. Do within your own domain, whatever you can do. Everyone has a responsibility. Everyone according to their level of authority. Our authority is different from the authority of the ruler or the king. Everyone has a responsibility. You do within your own, and they will have to do their own, and everyone will have to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the first part, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. So the reason for not answering is if we don't answer Allah. So we answer Allah, Allah will answer us. So this is the meaning of فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي, let them listen to me and answer me, and not to do against me. That's the number one. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. And the second one is وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. Let them believe in me. It's not the bare belief in Allah. It's to believe that Allah is there and listening to us. It's to believe that Allah is listening to our dua and He will answer us even if He doesn't give it to us. Because of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said, any believer making any dua, but Allah will give it to him in one of three ways. Any of you making dua to Allah, Allah will give it to you in one of three ways. Either, number one, either He will answer it for you and He will fulfill your wish now, And this is what most of us want, right? I ask, I want the answer immediately. This is what we love. But Allah says, He will give it to us. Or the second option is, Allah will relieve us from a hardship or calamity equivalent to that dua. Huh? The second, يَدْفَعْ عَنْكَ بِهَا سُوءٍ. Allah will relieve the person from a calamity or hardship equivalent to that dua. The third one is Allah will give you reward in the hereafter, multiples of that dua. And you know what? Everyone, when they see the reward in the hereafter, they would wish Allah would have answered no dua in this world because of the reward they will see for their dua. This is what يؤمنوا به. This is to believe Allah is there and will answer. Allah will compensate us for the dua. Allah will give us the reward of this dua. This is فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي. This is how the dua will be of value to us. This Allah will answer our dua. Allah will give it to us in one of these three ways. This is why He say فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي. Before we close, always we say, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, Ya Rab. It's exactly like you need to make some credit with Allah. So when you need it, you draw from that. It's exactly like you have a bank account and you have the key, you have the card and you have the key. And you keep saying, I need the money. You put the card and you punch the key and then you draw the money. But you know what? After a couple of transactions, you put the card when you are in the need of money and there's no money. Why? Because there is no credit. You did not deposit any money lately. You didn't put any money in your account. So when you put the card, you don't blame the card. There's nothing wrong with the card. Don't blame your PIN code. There is nothing wrong. There is nothing wrong with the ATM. Nothing wrong with the bank. There is something wrong with your account. Your account doesn't have enough credit. So, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, and Allah is not answering. Don't blame Allah, He's not listening. No, He's listening, but you don't have credit. I didn't have credit. I didn't abstain from haram. I didn't make enough good deeds. I didn't. But I still, so when I need Allah, I need to be in help, need of my brothers. That's what Allah says. مَنْ كَانَ فِي حَاجَةِ أَخِيهِ كَانَ اللَّهُ فِي حَاجَتِهِ. If you help your brothers, Allah will be in your side when you need Him. This is what He's saying. Exactly. So make enough credit for yourself by helping your fellow Muslims and people. This way, this is your credit. You will find it in your account. So when you put your card, you will draw the money and you will find Allah next to you. مَنْ نَفَّسَ عَنْ مُؤْمِنٍ كُرْبَةً مِنْ كُرَبِ الدُّنْيَا نَفَّسَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ كُرْبَةً مِنْ كُرَبِ الْآخِرَةِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. Whoever relieves a believer from the calamities of this world, Allah will relieve her or him from a calamity of the hereafter. This is your credit with Allah. So when you say, Ya Rab, I'm in trouble, in no time the answer will come to you because you have enough credit with Allah. And you know what? Because you help your fellow people with your help. You know, the person who helped even the animal, Allah was in their side and helped them. This is their credit in their account. So build your account with some credit by helping others, and you will find it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your siyam and dua. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our income halal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answer our dua. May Allah help our brothers and Muslims all around the world. May Allah bring peace to Muslims in Syria and in Yemen, in Palestine, and to this land and all of the lands around. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your fasting. In Ramadan, if next Friday is the Eid day, then it's two choices. If you make the Salatul Eid in congregation, you have the choice to make Salatul Jum'ah or not. This is the fiqh opinion. But if you don't make Salatul Eid in Jama'ah, you must make Salatul Jum'ah. You're not exempt from that. Is that clear? So, but you have the choice to make both of them, because it will be held. Salatul Jum'ah will be held as normal. But for those who make Salatul Eid, it's optional for them to make Salatul Jum'ah or not. But of course, it's more appropriate to make it so we can populate the masjids around. Usually, Salatul Eid, brothers, is 20 minutes, the Iqamat Salatul Eid, after Shuruq. After sun rises, 15 to 20 minutes, Salatul Eid is. So make sure you come to the masjid early, inshallah, because 20 minutes exactly, Salatul Eid happens in where the congregation is. In this masjid, it will be held, inshallah. Jazakumullahu khairan.